miracle can happen now. For the Spirit of the Lord is here. The evidence is all around. And the Spirit of the Lord is here. A miracle can happen now. For the Spirit of the Lord is here. The evidence is all around. The Spirit of the Lord is here.
Morning church, let's all stand up and worship our mighty God. Let our praise be the weapon today. Thank you, Lord. Let it praise.
Watch the giants fall, for fear cannot survive when we pray. Father, for today. Lord, we do thank you, Father, that we are able to worship you and praise you, Lord God, even though we can't see one another, Lord God, physically. But Lord, we know, Father, that we're still together. We're still one, Lord God, as brothers and sisters. And it's wonderful to be able to come together in this way, Lord. Lord, even if it is online, Lord God, we're still together. We serve the one God, the same God that's here right now, who's in each home. So, Father, we just pray, Lord, that today we'll have hearts of worship, Lord God. Let every heart be open, Lord God, to worship you, Father, this morning. We are blessed to have you as our God and our Savior, and that we can trust in you, Lord. So we just want to praise you in Jesus' name this morning. Amen. Amen. Welcome this morning, and we will be, we just want to welcome everyone who's watching online. We welcome you too. It's good to have you watching, and we pray that you will be blessed today and as always. And we're looking forward to what God has to share with us as Pastor Chris bring his word a bit later on. So we're going to go through the GROW news first thing this morning. Okay, so again, welcome to each one, wherever you're watching from. I know some of you are watching from the Philippines, which is great. Welcome, and some of you are watching from all different places, even different places around the world. I heard that people from Malta are watching as well. So we just want to welcome you all here, all watching online. So all programs are in recess at the moment because of the school holidays. All the leaders are having a good break at the moment, and praise God, we all need a break from time to time, and this is a time where we can all have a rest during the school holidays. The CRC National Conference, that will be coming up shortly. Pastor Chris will be sending an email very soon, and we'll let you know more about it, about the conference. Catch up after the service. There'll be no GROW kits today, but we'll be able to catch with one another again straight after the service. We're going to come around communion this morning, so if you... having got the cup ready and a piece of biscuit, please go and get something ready so you can participate with us as we share in communion. And we're going to share two verses of scripture this morning from Romans chapter 3, verses 23 and 24. For all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God, and all are justified freely by His grace through the redemption that came by Christ Jesus. Okay, the Bible tells us that people are made right with God by His grace, which is, of course, a free gift. Grace is a free gift that has been given to us all. And then in Ephesians chapter 2, verse 5, it says that God made us alive with Christ, even when we were dead in transgressions. So it is by grace that you and I have been saved. We were spiritually dead because of the things we did wrong against God. And I'm sure all of us done a lot of wrong things against God in the past. But God gave us a new life with Christ. You know, insurance companies, they talk about new for old. You know, you got possessions, and if something happens, a flood or a fire, they'll give you new for old stuff. And that's nothing new to Christ. Because I have to tell you that God thought of that concept a very, very long time ago. And God offers us a new life for an old life. It does not depend on the quality of the used life or how we used to live before. This is an unconditional offer, and anyone can apply. That's the good news. Anyone can apply. There are no special conditions. God will accept anyone who will come to Him in good faith. Grace is the free gift of new life because of the blood of Jesus Christ. And it is free for us, but it was expensive for Jesus. It cost Jesus everything that He had. All of this because God loves us so much that He wants us to be in heaven for eternity with Him. It's so good. It's so simple. And it's so true. You will receive this offer. Will you receive this offer today? If you haven't already, don't wait another day. There's an opportunity to accept Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior. Let's pray. You can stand wherever you are. If you're sitting on the sofa or if you're still in bed, you can stand with us as we partake of communion this morning. Father, we do thank you, Lord God, that as we hold this bread, Father, in our hands, Lord, we know that this represents the broken body of our Lord Jesus Christ. Lord, we thank you so much for what you've done for us, for each one of us, Lord. Lord, we can do this because, Lord, you love us so much because of what you've done for us. So, Lord, as we take this bread, we just want to say thank you for all you've done. Let's eat together. And as we hold the cup, the cup represents the blood of our Lord Jesus Christ that was shed for us. We're so blessed that we have such a wonderful God who loves us so much, who would die for us, be beaten, and then let His blood pour out for us. How can we ever forget? How can we ever forget what you've done for us? So we thank you for that blood that you've shed for us, Lord. Let's drink together. Father, we thank you that now we know we have everlasting life with you, Lord. Lord, and in spite of what's happening around us, Lord, we are secure because of what you've done for us, Lord. And Lord, we can stand here this morning, Lord, knowing, Lord, that you're never going to leave us nor forsake us, that it doesn't matter what's going on around us. We can trust you, Lord. You can be trusted, Father. And Lord, we thank you that we can have that joy in our heart, knowing, Lord God, that you are near, you within each one of us, Lord. What security that is, Lord. And we feel that joy, Lord, that joy that comes from you. Lord, the world cannot give that joy, Lord God. The world will give joy, but for a short time. But you give joy, Father, that never ends, that doesn't depend on what we're going through. Lord, we just thank you, Father, that you accepted us as we received you as our Lord and Savior. You said, yes, come in. Yes, come in. And Lord, I just pray this morning too, Father, for anyone that hasn't committed themselves to you, Lord God. Lord, I pray that they will not miss out. They will not miss out anymore, Lord God, for you have so much for each one, Lord. So we just want to thank you and praise you, Lord, this morning in Jesus' name. Let's just continue to worship our Lord this morning.
Stop.
that our trust is in you, that you will make the way. You will make the path straight for us, O Lord God. And we thank you, Lord, that praise is our weapon. We thank you, Lord, that we need to praise you. We need to pour out our love and adoration to you, Jesus, for all that you have done. We thank you, Jesus, that you are the author and finisher of our faith. Thank you, Lord God. You're a mighty God. You're a mighty God, a holy God. And Father, we stand in awe of you. Hallelujah, Jesus. We worship you.
Praise you and worship you, Lord God. Again, whether we're at home, whether we're here, Father, we know that your presence is with us. For your presence, Father, is always, always with us, Lord God. Whether we're going through a valley, whether we're having a good time, Lord God, your presence is always with us. And we are so blessed, Lord God. So, Father, you're worthy to be praised, Lord, as we worship you this morning, Father. We want to lift you up, Lord God, for you're a good God. You're our God. You are our Father and our Savior. So, Lord, this morning, I just pray that every heart, Lord, will worship you and will praise you. You will praise your mighty name. Thank you, Lord, that you've blessed us so much, Father. You blessed us so much, Father. There's nothing we need, Lord God, because you bless us with all things. You bless us with all our needs. So, Father, we just pray, Lord, that today we'll continue to worship you, Lord. Lord, we don't stop here, Father. We'll continue to worship you, Lord, because you are worthy to be praised, worthy to be worshipped, Lord God. So, Father, we just want to say that we love you. We thank you, Lord God. We thank you, Lord God, that you are with us, Lord. And knowing that you are with us, Father, Lord, we don't look at what's happening around us, but we look to you because you bring comfort. You bring peace into our heart. Lord, we're so blessed to feel that peace within each one of us, Father. And we can do that because of you, because you're in our lives, Father. So we thank you and praise you again this morning, Lord. And we have a scripture in Matthew chapter 22, verse 21. Caesar, they replied. Then he said to them, so give back to Caesar what is Caesar's, and to God what is God's. So here as Christ's followers, we have an obligation to our earthly governments, but also have an obligation to God. And it is our responsibility as Christians to obey the law of the land, as long as it is, of course, not, it's not sinful to do so, but always also to obey God. And so today, as we give to God, we give to God what belongs to Him. And we give always with joyful hearts. And we're so blessed in this church that people still giving, this online there where you can give, that will come up. And we thank each one of you that you are so faithful in your giving. Let's pray. Father, we do thank you, Lord, again for these tithes and offerings, Father. Lord, just pray that we'll continue to bless them, Father. Bless each person, Lord, that gives so diligently, Lord God, week after week, Father. Lord, we want to put you first in everything, Lord God. And Lord, as we give, Father, we don't give you leftovers, Father. It's so easy to just go and do everything we have to do with our finances, Lord God, and then leave you for last. But Lord, we want to put you first, Father. We want to put you first because you've put us first, Lord God. You've gave us all, Lord God. And Lord, all you ask is for a small portion, Father, of our income. So we give this morning. We give with joyful hearts, Lord. And also those coins for missions, Lord God. We pray that we'll continue to bless the Philippines, Father, and Cebu, Lord God, as they go to the training center. And we pray that we'll continue to see leaders and pastors, Father, in that place going out and spreading your word, Lord God, bringing others into your kingdom, Father. So we thank you and praise you, Lord, in Jesus' name. Amen. Invite our senior pastor this morning to come and bring God's word. He brought us a wonderful and beautiful word last week, and I'm sure it's going to be as good today. So welcome, Pastor Chris Colley.
Well, good morning, everyone. Great to see you this morning. Well, not that I can really see you, but glad that you're joining with us. And again, we're still in lockdown here, but it's so great that we're able to connect in this way. We just pray that God continues to bless you as we connect in this way and as God ministers to each and every one of us. We've had an incredible week, quite an unusual week. We've just seen amazing things with the writers, scenes in Melbourne, doing things that perhaps we never thought that we would see here. And of course, we had an earthquake, and it's quite interesting that some people are saying, oh, earthquake must be the end of times, must be a sign of the end of the times. Well, and so fortunately, it's good that I'm actually continuing to talk about the end times, not really fortunately. I think the Lord leads us at the right time. And so before we open the word, let's just begin to pray together. Father, we just thank you, Lord, that we can come around your word, Lord. Your word is life to us, Lord, and it encourages us, Lord. It lifts us up, Father. Lord, you don't just inform and educate us, Lord, but you transform us and change us by the work of your Spirit. And Lord, I pray, Lord, as we open your word today, Lord, that you speak to us, Lord, and encourage us, Lord, as we learn more about you, Lord, but the wonderful, wonderful hope that we have in Jesus Christ, our coming King. And so, Lord, we just commit everything to you now in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Well, last week, and hopefully if you didn't catch that, you were able to catch it on the YouTube channel or Facebook page if you missed it. But last week we introduced looking at the end times and spent a bit of time talking about some of the different ways of looking at the book of Revelation in particular, and also looking at particularly pertaining to the mark of the beast, because there's a lot of fear and a bit of angst and misunderstanding regarding the mark of the beast. And so we spent a bit of time looking at that. And today I want to look at the particular area, looking at the area of the rapture and the tribulation. And so I want to talk about those things today. But I want to start with a scripture from 1 Peter chapter 1 and verse 23, and it says this: if you've been born again, but not to a life that will quickly end, your new life will last forever because it comes from the eternal living word of God. And that's just a wonderful encouragement to us. It's not for this life that we are living. This life is important as we find Christ, as we grow in character, and as we fulfill the plans and purposes that God has for us, the things that he's made us for, and as we prepare our hearts and be prepared for eternity. All those things are very important. But we do have a life. It says your new life will last forever because it comes from the eternal living word of God. And we have a wonderful eternal hope in our Lord Jesus Christ, as we remembered around the communion table not that long ago. And so I want to talk about some things pertaining to the end times, and particularly when we talk about the rapture and the tribulation. And certainly one of the things with the earthquake that we had during the week here at Melbourne, I think it was 5.8 or 5.9, depending on which report it is. And even though it was quite unusual for us, apparently there's over 800 earthquakes of that size every year across the world. But certainly for us, it was startling and certainly makes people think about end times things. So I want to talk about the rapture and the tribulation. Now, just one of the things I want to say right from the very beginning, that every Christian and every generation across history, we have to live our life with the expectation that Jesus Christ is coming back at any time. He's coming soon, and that we are to be ready. We have our hearts prepared. And certainly the parable of Matthew 25, the wise and the foolish virgins, that parable there is really about making sure that we're ready. We've got the oil in the lamp. We're waiting for the Lord to come and return. And that's certainly one of my encouragements for us as we look at these things today, is that in our hearts, we will have that heart to be ready and waiting for the coming of the Lord. Now, you'll find I'm just going to put up there, you see up there on the screen there, you'll see a little table that comes up there. And I'm going to go through that in detail in just a moment. We'll just leave it there for a second. Why that's there is because where we're going to be talking about the rapture and the tribulation, there is actually a context for that. And as I pointed out last time, there's different views of ways of looking at Revelation, whether it was a preterist view, the idealistic view, whether we were looking at the historical futurist view, looking at the area of the book of Revelation. There are some views when we look at the wider picture of eschatology, and particularly as it encompasses things such as the rapture and the tribulation. And that's what this that little table up there that you would have seen a moment ago was talking about. And so there are some different views. Now, again, as I go through these things, if you hold a contrary position or a different thing, it doesn't matter. We stand united on the things that Christ died on the cross for our sins. He died in our place for our sin, that he rose again and is reigning, living with power and authority. He's conquered sin. He's conquered death. He is the one whose name is above every name, the one that we lift up, the worship. We lift him up and glorify him as he is glorified as our risen Savior and our Lord and our King. And certainly we know that he is returning, no question. No one has any questions about the fact that Jesus Christ is coming back, and he will come back with glory and majesty and splendor. And so, but there are some different views of working out how things happen in terms of the end times. And I just want to touch on a couple of particular areas of the rapture and the tribulation. But the context of that is to understand, look, there are some different views. And again, as I said, if you hold a different view, not a problem. But I just want to present some things. First of all, what are some of the different views? And then present some thoughts that I have on these particular issues. So first of all, you'll see up there, the first view that we'll have up there is the amillennial view or amillennialism. And the word just means means not having. Now, when we talk about millennial, I'll come back to a scripture verse. That when we're talking about this millennial thing, what are we talking about when we're talking about things being post-millennial, pre-millennial or amillennial? What's this millennial thing that we're talking about? Well, basically it's referring to, in the book of Revelation, in the chapter 20 and verse 4 to 6, it talks about this 1,000-year reign, this millennial reign. Now, that's important as it's a key factor in understanding some of the wider views of looking at things for the end times. And so the particular passage is in Revelation chapter 20, 4 to 6, and I'll just quickly read that to you. It said, "Then I saw thrones, and people sitting on them had been given authority to judge. And I saw the souls of those who had been beheaded for their testimony about Jesus and for proclaiming the word of God. They not had worshipped the beast or his statue," we talked about the mark of the beast last time, "not accepted his mark on their foreheads or their hands. They will come to life again, and they will reign with Christ for 1,000 years. So 1,000 years, a millennial, this is where we get that term from. Not found anywhere else in Scripture, the only place that it's mentioned. This is the first resurrection. The rest of the dead will not come back to life until the 1,000 years has ended. And so this part of this millennium, it is a part of the whole package, if you like, as we're talking about specifically about the rapture and then tribulation, but knowing the context here of this millennial, because it's the different views we actually use this to help delineate the different ways of looking at things. So first of all, getting back to what I mentioned before, is this thing called amillennialism. And when something is it was amoral, it meant it was without moral. So if you say amillennial, we're saying there's basically no millennial, there's not a 1,000-year reign in this particular view. And you'll notice for each view that I've popped up there, we've got there, what is the view in terms of this particular way of looking at things? What is the view of the rapture? What is the view of the tribulation? What is the view of the millennial reign, the 1,000-year reign? And how do they see Israel under this particular view? So under this very first view here, which is amillennial, which literally means there's no millennial, but what this view says is that the thousand-year period, if you like, is really only a symbolic thing, a symbolic period, and it started with the ascension of Christ. And there's this time where there's this church age, where there's the church is growing and advancing. Yep, kingdom of evil is also growing and advancing as well at that time. But the church is, the kingdom of God is defined as the kingdom of God, and the church being there will bless culture. But then after a time of the church, the belief that after a period of time, the church will become apostate. In other words, it'll fall into idolatry, into wickedness, and drift away from the central tenets of the faith. It'll become apostate. And at which time that Satan would be released and wreak some havoc, and then the Lord would come back. And that's basically, so by some havoc, I mean a tribulation, a short period of tribulation, persecute the church, and then Jesus would come back. And so that's what that first view is actually saying. And so when they look at it, they say that the rapture is immediately coming back to Christ. And I'll talk about rapture, what we mean about that later on. But basically, rapture just means to be caught up, to be snatched away, is literally what it means. And so they believe that that when people are lifted up, it's immediately prior to the coming of Jesus Christ. And so it says there's going to be this intense time of tribulation before the Lord then comes back. But they see 1,000 years as only something symbolic. And so that's one way of looking at things when we talk about that. And you'll see there in the little timeline there, it'll help explain to you that, yep, we've got the cross, you've got this age that we're in now, and then this persecution that's going to come, and immediately the Lord will return after that. Another view is called the post-millennialism view. And basically this is saying that there is the rapture of the Lord. He will come back immediately with the second coming, and the rapture of the same thing, coming back immediately at that time. And basically saying that there's no real tribulation period, that was all happened around AD 70, and we'll talk about that a little bit later. And looks at this millennium, this thousand-year reign, or this 1,000 years, as saying that it's actually not literal. It's not a literal thing at all. So previous view said, no, it was not at all. This is saying, well, there is, but it's not actually literal. And basically, this particular viewpoint says that the kingdom of God is going to keep preaching and growing and expanding across the face of the earth. And and as it grows, this kingdom age, this golden kingdom age that we will enter into, the church growing in influence so that just about every person is saved, most people getting saved on the face of the earth. Although I must admit, to me, that doesn't quite marry up with Jesus saying about the narrow road and only few will actually go through there. But this is what this particular point of view says. So this growing church of influence, and church being synonymous with Israel, the church is Israel, the fulfillment of Israel. And after this golden kingdom age, Christ will then return with the general resurrection, and then the judgment will come at that time. And so that's another view of looking at all of these things. And so, again, they're not saying that there's the tribulation, saying it's already happened, and it's saying there's no first rapture of the church going and then the Lord coming back as a separate event. It's saying those things are together. Now, two other very popular views, or, different levels of popularity, but others that have grown in popularity and certainly started with a popularity right amongst even the founders of the early church, was this particular one. We have a look at this area of pre-tribulational premillennialism. And that sounds like a big mouthful, because it is. Or this dispensational way of looking at things as well. And this particular model, as you can see there, believes that there is a secret rapture, that Jesus will come back and secretly the church will be taken up to the Lord and meet him in the air and then disappear for 7 years while there's this period of tribulation. Well, the Antichrist will come, and then they say that they're 3.5 years later, so there'll be relative peace for 3.5 years as the world governments form, world church, all of those things are formed. The Temple of Israel is built, rebuilt. There's institution of worship, and then the beast comes at halfway through that, and the whole thing turns on its head, and this time of tribulation. And then after another 3.5 years, then Jesus comes back in the second coming, and then entering this age where the temple is established with worship under Jesus Christ. They institute sacrifices again as memorial offerings or sacrifices unto Jesus. And so that the whole thing there, they have this is that there is a secret rapture. And I want to talk about that because that's become a very popular point of view, that we're all going to suddenly get raptured off, and then the people will be driving on freeways, cars are going to be crashing because the car just kept on going, and people are going to be doing stuff, planes will fall out of the air, and all of these things are made very popular by some movies and the whole Left Behind series. And a lot of people are holding to that. Well, I want to talk about specifically about that, because the scripture doesn't actually, in my opinion, some will argue against me, and that's entitled their opinion, but there is no secret rapture as far as I'm concerned. But this is what this particular view would hold. And it says that there is really a separate redemptive plan for the church and for Israel. And it's called dispensationalism because it divides up the history, if you like, into different ages, different segments of history, these dispensations. And so basically, in a nutshell, what that view actually believes. And so after the millennial reign of Christ, after 1,000 years, Satan is loosed. Again, there's another big battle climactically. Satan is turfed in the pit, and that's the end of Fiery Lake, and that's the end of it. And so that's basically how they see that. So Satan is bound for 1,000 years during that reign. He comes out, rages battle once again, and gets finally defeated. And every one of these accounts, when we have Jesus coming back, we have him defeating all the work of the enemy. Another view is the historical view, or the post-tribulational premillennialism. And again, these things just, if all these things make your head begin to spin, don't worry, my head's done a lot of spinning over the time trying to get a hold of all these things. And I don't fully, can't grip all of these things. And I'm not pretending that I'm an expert, but just giving us a general nutshell of each of these particular one. This is very similar to the previous one that we looked at. If you notice that, there's a seven-year time of that tribulation period. By the way, they get the 7 years from the book of Daniel, and Daniel's 70th week, this week of the seven-year period of tribulation. That's where that seven-year period is actually derived from in both of those particular beliefs, both premillennial views. The difference between this one and the one that we just spoke about, between the dispensationalism view or the pre-tribulational view, this is post-tribulation, so this is afterwards. The difference mainly there is that they don't believe that there is a secret rapture, that there's a rapture prior to Christ coming back, that we'll go along and we're still coming up until this time, this futuristic view still, of coming into a time of intense tribulation and all of the things, Christ coming back, establishing 1,000-year reign, so binding up Satan, then having 1,000-year reign, releasing Satan again to do his worst again, and then after that, again, there's another battle. So the previous battle of Armageddon, then there's a subsequent battle 1,000 years later, and he's thrown finally in the lake of fire for good and eternal judgment. And so these are some of the different views that you'll see. Basically running up into this particular view again is this a time of apostasy. The church starts to fall away into sin and wickedness and compromise, and that really is the thing that leads into this tribulation. So the difference there is that there's no secret rapture in that particular point of view. Now, I've gone over these quickly because we've got a lot to cover, so I encourage you to have a look. I'm actually going to put this table in the link so you can have a look at it, and if you want to know a little bit more about these different views, you can go on and have a look at it. Now, personally, where do I stand? Well, my viewpoint actually doesn't fit in neatly with any of these particular ones. I can see differences in each of these things. For example, the golden church age of everyone on the earth being saved, I have issues with that. Certainly don't believe in a secret rapture in terms of a coming mark of the beast and a coming tribulation period and all of those things. I don't hold to that view personally. And so what I feel actually doesn't necessarily feel neatly into any of these particular categories, but these are major views that are out there, and people strongly argue, and they biblically argue strongly different points of view on this. And again, if you have grab one of these views and say, yep, that's what I believe, then all power to you. And I'm not trying to persuade you from one view to another. I'm just trying to have a bit of an understanding so that really what is the heart of these things, which we'll get to at the end. So they're those views. So basically, why don't I believe in a secret rapture? I want to tackle that particular one because that has become quite populist and many people believing that, expecting that they'll be sitting there and driving in the car, as I said, and someone disappears or whatever it is. Where does all that come from? And just as I mentioned before, the word rapture means to be caught up or to be snatched away, quite literally, as to be raptured. And so where does that concept come from, people talking about this rapture anyway? Where does it come about? Now, as I said before, remember, there's no disagreement about Christ coming and returning and coming with power and authority and victory, coming in glory and splendor. No controversy about that. The only things that people are a little unsure of, or ways of disagreeing, if you like, not really disagreeing, but different opinions, is on these other issues. But certainly why I don't believe in this secret rapture. But what is this rapture? It comes from, really first mentioned, the book of Daniel. And it is an important book, Daniel 7, and you can read onwards through the subsequent chapters there, giving a picture of end times as well. And again, I don't have time to cover all of these things. I'm just really just scratching the tip of it, just the tip of the iceberg on all of these things. There's so much stuff, and we don't have time to cover everything. But Daniel 7, it says, "In my vision at night I looked, and there before me was one like the Son of Man," which is a picture obviously of Christ, "coming with the clouds of heaven. He approached the Ancient of Days, the Father, and was led into his presence." And so this is the first real image that we have about him coming with the clouds of heaven. And we read that in Daniel 7. But then we find that repeated. So that was in the Old Testament prophets. We have that with Daniel. But then Jesus talks about it in Matthew 24. And again, that's an important passage. And by the way, Jesus actually refers to the book of Daniel. So Jesus certainly saw it was important in terms of looking at some issues of things that were going to happen for sure prophetically. Matthew 24, verse 30 to 31, it says, "Then will appear the sign of the Son of Man in heaven, and then all the peoples of the earth will mourn when they see the Son of Man coming on the clouds of heaven with power and great glory. And he will send out his angels with a loud trumpet call, and they will gather his elect from the four winds, from one end of the heavens to the other." So the people have just been drawn up to the Lord as he is there, coming in glory and authority. And perhaps even a little bit more clearer, if you like, where we get this from is from the book, from the Apostle Paul's writing within his letters. And there's certainly quite a lot of end time things that you will find there, a lot of eschatology the statements that are made there, and even in Peter as well, there's different statements that are made. But it says in 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, and this is probably the key one where people really get this concept and this phrase from, 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, verses 16 and 17. It says, "For the Lord himself will come down from heaven with a loud command, and the voice of the archangel, and with the trumpet call of God, and the dead in Christ will rise first." Amen. "After that, we who are still alive and who are left will be caught up together with them into the clouds to meet the Lord in the air. And so we will be with the Lord forever." And so the idea of all of us, that so the dead in Christ being raised up, and then those that are still alive, we're being caught up together to be raptured is the word that people use, but to be caught up into the clouds with the Lord's presence. Now, so that's really the whole concept of the rapture comes from. But it's certainly, as I read through the scripture, it certainly is not a secret thing that people won't notice or see. In fact, already from the way that I've read these, the things I've seen, you heard about the loud command and the voice of the archangel and the trumpet call of God, you'll hear those things going. Now, there are those who argue that those things, that's actually different from the description of Jesus coming back when he returns to the earth. I would actually argue they actually are synonymous. They are the same thing. But it's certainly not a secret. The idea of it being a secret does come from Matthew 24, as I mentioned, verses 40 to 42. "Two men will be in the field, one will be taken, the other left. Two women will be grinding with one hand a mill, one will be taken and the other left. Therefore, keep watch, because you do not know the day when your Lord will come. And so that one was going to be taken and the other will be left behind. And it sounds like a good name for a book and a movie series, and that's what people have done. And that's really where the concept comes from, of this secret rapture and people being left behind. But if you have a look at it already said, that there's certainly not a secret thing. Jesus says in Matthew 24:27, for as lightning comes out of the east, is visible even in the west, so will be the coming of the Son of Man. And so it's going to be a dramatic thing. People are going to know. It's not no secret. There's no secrets mentioned here in Scripture. It's going to be a very visible, very obvious thing. And picture in 1 Corinthians 15, again, another important passage if you want to look at. I'm just touching some of these passages. If you really want to get into it, it's a good passage to get into, the whole 1 Corinthians chapter 15. But verses 51 and 52, it says, listen, I tell you a mystery. We will not all sleep, but we will all be changed in a flash, in the twinkling of an eye, of the last trumpet. For the trumpet will sound and the dead will be raised imperishable and we will be changed. And so the whole idea of us, when we're caught up to being the Lord and we're changed with him, there's trumpets, and people say, oh no, it's a spiritual thing that only hear. If that's your interpretation of it, you're quite welcome to put that on there. Certainly I don't do that. I think that makes it very visible. It's like lightning. Eyes will see, people are going to mourn because, oh no, the Lord's come. People are going to see, they're going to hear, they're going to notice. And certainly one of the reasons why people think it's a secret is because the Bible talks about the Lord coming like a thief. And Scripture does say that in Revelation 16 and 15. It says, look, I come like a thief. Blessed is the one who stays awake and remains clothed. So coming like a thief. So people think, aha, well, that's very secretive, you know. People won't know because he's coming like a thief. The image of a thief there is really not the image of somebody sneaking around. It's more like an image of like a home invasion, the thief just bursting in and taking things. It can be quite a violent image, not necessarily a little creepy sneaking around image. 1 Thessalonians 5:2, for you know very well the day of the Lord will come like a thief in the night. But the whole point of the idea of him coming like a thief was not that he was going to be coming to make a secret rapture for us to disappear. The point that Jesus is making in these passages, what Jesus is making in Matthew 24 when he discusses it, and certainly what the Apostle Paul saying in 1 Thessalonians and the writer John in Revelation, is the whole point is that he's coming when we don't know. And he even says, look, if you knew when a thief was going to come and break into your house, you'd make sure that that wasn't going to happen. And so the whole point is being ready, because he's going to come at a time when we don't expect it. And really part of my heart in sharing this is today is to ask you, are you ready? Are you living with that expectation that Jesus can come back anytime? Because he can. And it's going to come back without any. Now, there's going to be signs of the ends of times. The Scripture talks about signs, and I'll talk a little bit more later, but Jesus talks about it in Mark 13, Luke 21, Matthew 24. He talks a bit about these end times and things, talks about sign, the fig tree, you'll know the signs. Well, you might know the season, but you don't know the time. And every generation has lived with the expectation that Jesus is coming, and certainly you need to do that. Because Jesus can come back at any time, and I would not want to be one who was found naked or caught wanting, who was not clothed in righteousness, that had to face the Almighty God in my own righteousness. I wouldn't want, and my heart aches for those people that really that's their predicament, that's the situation that they're in if they don't know the Lord Jesus Christ. So we have to be ready, so it's unexpected. And so, okay, so the idea, yep, there is this meeting in the air, this whole concept of a rapture that is certainly not going to be a secret thing, and it's certainly not going to be but it will be unexpected. So not secret, but unexpected. But what about the tribulation? Because we're part of looking at those things that I showed you earlier is saying people are raptured up before this great tribulation happens. And that gives a lot of comfort to people, because the idea of going through a great tribulation, I won't have to go through that. If we're all whisked away for safety and up with the Lord for 7 years while the rest of the earth are going through torment and turmoil with the Antichrist driving up and then all the judgment of God unleashed and things, and it certainly has an attraction. But why don't I believe in that? Why don't I believe in a secret rapture where we raptured up before this great tribulation? Well, certainly we've got to understand the word. When it talks about the Lord coming, there is a word there which is parousia, which really means, or parousia, which means coming alongside or in his presence. It means it's really presence is probably a word. And so when he comes, that we will be in his presence. So when the Lord comes. And so I'm equating the rapture and the second coming as the same event, not a first part of part A, second coming, and then a part B, second coming, just a second coming. And basically the image is that, and certainly from 1 Thessalonians 4, where we're caught up into the clouds, and the imagery is be very easily understood by the New Testament Christians that understand what this means in terms of first century Christians, early Christians, around the time that these letters were written. They would understand certainly what that was about. And basically what it means is that what would happen is when the image is basically two images here. One image is when like a conquering king comes. When the conqueror would come into the city, then the people would go out, all the citizens would go out to them, and they would go out and they would see the conqueror in, and they would be cheering and clapping, and then they would come in with him. And that's like the image that we have here. Or the other image is like when we have the emperor. If the emperor was coming to one of the outlying provinces, and remember the Roman context, the Roman rule and authority, we talked about that last week. The other image is the Roman emperor coming, and he's coming into this Roman province. And so all the citizens would go out and they would applaud the emperor. He is coming, the king is coming, the coming king, he's coming. He is coming in there, and the people go out and they all come in there, and then they all come in together. And really, that is the imagery that we have. And that's why I equate them both simultaneously, that we're all called up, we meet the Lord in the air, and then he comes down and into what we'll talk about next week. And so that's why I don't believe in a secret rapture, and I certainly don't equate them as two separate events. As some of those views will agree with that. You find that the amillennialist view and the post-millennial view also hold that view, whereas it's the other view, the premillennial views, that hold the view the dispensational view holds the view of this secret rapture. And I certainly don't hold to that. All right, so if there's not a secret rapture, then, well, what about the tribulation? So where does it leave us? If I've said already that I don't believe that we're going to be whisked up before this great tribulation, well, what does that mean? Does that mean we're going to be here when the mark of the beast comes? Well, hopefully, if you watched last week or you heard last week, you realise, well, hang on, we're not living in fear of the mark of the beast coming. We're not living in fear of those things. And so we're not necessarily looking to escape from this great tribulation, because certainly from all I've said before, that I certainly believe those things have been fulfilled. And I'll just talk a little bit more about that in the few minutes that we have left. So why don't I not believe in this future great tribulation that is coming? Well, just right from the beginning, can I just say, first of all, I say there's always going to be persecution. There'll always be persecution. That antichrist spirit, the spirit of the devil working on that, the spirit of lawlessness, all of those things are going to be still at work in this earth. And we will suffer persecution. That Babylonian spirit, the corrupt world system, which is always going to be there with its beastly outworking, we're always going to have to deal with that across the generation. Every generation has to deal with that in different ways, contextually each to their own generation. And we certainly will have persecutions. And we're warned about that in James 1, 2. It said, "Consider it pure joy, my brothers and sisters, when you face trials of many kinds." And I just wonder, just as an aside, how many of us right now, when we're locked down for this never-ending lockdown here in Victoria, in particular here in Melbourne, we consider it pure joy? And it actually challenges me when I think about that, because I don't always consider it pure joy. But it says, consider it joy when you face trials of many kinds. And so we see that, okay, well, the Lord is with me in all of whatever I'm going through. But one of the reasons why I don't believe in this future great tribulations is the sense that it's already been fulfilled. Some of the key passages are that Jesus spoke about, as I mentioned, Mark 13, Matthew 24, Luke 21. As far as I'm concerned, reading this, they clearly refer to the destruction of the temple which was destroyed by Titus, who then went on to become emperor in AD 70, that those things particularly happen. And so when you hear about prior to those, there's going to be rumours of wars and earthquakes and those things. And certainly they had all of those things there. They've always been going on. All of those things around that time, there were some signs that were given. And then when the temple was Jerusalem was destroyed in AD 70, they destroyed the temple. They desecrated it. They had their Roman standards all over the place there and desecrated it. And so I believe those things, as already I mentioned last week in terms of looking at the mark of the beast, but all those other things that he talked about happened around that time in AD 70 with the destruction of Jerusalem. And Jesus in Luke 21:20 says, "When you see Jerusalem being surrounded by armies, you know that its desolation is near." And Jesus also refers in Matthew 24, it talks about, "So when you see standing in the holy place the abomination that causes desolation, spoken through of the prophet Daniel, let the reader understand." And so Jesus refers specifically back to Daniel, and then he's talking about these events of the destruction of the temple and the desecration of the temple, which actually did happen. Jesus foretold them and they happened within a generation. Remember, Jesus said that these things will happen within this generation. This generation will not pass away until these things have happened. He said that, Mark 13:13. You'll find each of the accounts. He says, this generation will not pass away until this has happened. And it did happen within the course of that generation. And that's one of the reasons, or the main reason why I don't believe that we're going to be facing this in the future, that it did happen. It was prophesied. Daniel put them there. And Jesus said, when you see the armies surrounding Jerusalem, it's exactly what happened in AD 70. It was like a 5-month siege before they're actually able to take it. A lot of big battles. And there was times Titus himself was almost captured at one stage. It was quite a remarkable story around there of that whole siege of Jerusalem. I believe that was fulfilled. So the parts of Daniel saw some fulfillment there, and also the things that Jesus was saying. And so part of that is that the judgment that really was to come on Jerusalem, I don't believe that on the Jews and the temple, where the temple had actually become the idol, the temple became more important than the one it was supposed to be worshipping. The judgment that was to come upon the Jewish nation, if you like, actually came upon that time at that destruction of the temple. They're not awaiting something happening in the future. And then Jesus, who was risen again, he is the temple, he is the new temple, if you like, is found in Jesus Christ. And as the embodiment of that, of heaven and earth colliding, Jesus is the focus of all of those things. And certainly as we have a look at and this other verse, and this is my final verse, so I'm about to finish, gives a lot more clarity to me on this issue of whether we're facing this coming great tribulation or it'll just be persecution. And those events that happened at that time talks about people that are pregnant, that, you know, it said if you're pregnant at that time, if you're nursing or you're pregnant at that time, you know, that's going to be a tough time. Flee into the mountains. Go up into the mountains of Judah. Well, if we have a look at these things coming, if that's all coming, we're not all going to be running to the mountains in Judah to be fleeing. We're not going to be fleeing in that way. But just this passage, just to finish with Luke 21, verses 24 to 28, it says this. They will fall by the sword and be taken prisoners to all nations. Jerusalem will be trampled on by the Gentiles. And then Jesus says, until the times of Gentiles are fulfilled. Because in each of those passages I mentioned, those three passages that I spoke about, Mark 13, Matthew 24, Luke 21, and even further on in Matthew 24, and keep reading there, in those passages there, in those situations, that they do end up with these incredible signs in heaven and then Jesus Christ coming, returning in triumph and glory and authority. Well, clearly, obviously, that hasn't happened. I don't believe that's happened. Jesus hasn't come back again. We're still waiting for him to return. But it said there they would be trampled on the Gentiles until the time of the Gentiles are fulfilled. And so there's this time of fulfillment of people coming in, coming into the kingdom of God. And it says, there will be, then it goes, so there's a time, and then it says, there will be signs on the sun, in the sun, moon, and stars. On the earth, nations will be in anguish and perplexing by the roaring and the tossing of the sea. People will faint from terror, apprehensive of what is coming on the world, for the heavenly bodies will be shaken at that time. They will see the Son of Man coming in power with glory, with power and great glory. And when these things begin to take place, stand up, lift up your heads, because your redemption is nigh. And so that these events that happened at that time in AD 70, which have been fulfilled, and this is now that the time of until the time of Gentiles, of people coming in, people who aren't born Jews, people are coming in to know Christ, that their only salvation is through Jesus Christ, not through right, whether you're born a Jew or not. It's salvation is purely under through the Lord Jesus Christ and coming to faith in Him. And for those who do, and as we come into faith, whether they were from a Jew or a Gentile, those who come to Christ, there's no distinction. When they come to Jesus, we come in this expectation of the Son of Man coming in a cloud with power and great glory. And when these things take place, stand up and lift up your head, because your redemption is drawn near. You won't be one who's tossing, and if you're one who is alive at that time, you'll be, oh, my redemption is here, praise God. Those who don't know the Lord will be in terror and horror and running to flee from the, as it says, the kings of the earth trying to flee, as it describes in Revelation when the Lord comes back. And so what is the overriding message that I want to bring today as we come to a close? Is number one is to be ready. Are you ready for Jesus to come back? Are you living your life that Jesus can come back at any time? Because He can. He can come back at any time. Are you living your life ready for that? And if you've given your life to Jesus Christ, you have a joyful expectation and you say, yes, Lord, I'm ready. And I'm not going to be found naked. I'm not going to be doing things I shouldn't be doing. I'm not going to be distracted or compromising or caught up with the world and having wrong values, wrong priorities, caught up in the world system, caught up in doing all of those things. Lord, I'm going to keep my mind and my heart, my focus on You. And yes, I do the work and the things I need to do to live. Obviously, we have to do those things, but they will not become the things that define my life or take over my life. And the pursuit of money, wealth, finance, power, or whatever will not be something that tries to take control of my life. And I want to honor and lift up and serve the living Christ with all of my life and with all of my heart. And so we want to be ones that be ready. If you don't know Jesus Christ, can I tell you, you're not ready? And my heart goes out to you, because I would not want to be one that when He comes in glory and you stand there as one who was an enemy of God, who then one have to stand before God in judgment and based on whether your name's written in the book of life, the only way to get your name in the book of life is to give your life to Jesus Christ. And so I pray that this day that you will give your heart and say, Lord, I don't want to be one that faces all the uncertainty. I want to be one who can look forward to your coming, not be one that's in horror, and surrender your life to Jesus Christ, asking to be the Lord and Savior, to forgive you for your sins, that you make peace with God, that the judgment that you would other have to have because of the things you've done is cancelled, as we talked about at communion, by the blood of Jesus Christ, His sacrifice, dying in your place, taking the punishment for your sins, and so that when you come before the Father, you are holy and righteous because of the Lord Jesus Christ, that your name is written in the book of life, and therefore you don't face the eternal judgment and the eternal penalty of that. So be ready. And the next thing really I want to say, be ready, but don't be afraid. You don't live in fear. Don't be people that give in to fear. All the things that are happening on the world, look up, keep your head up, keep your faith up, keep your focus up on the Lord Jesus Christ, who reigns and rules supreme. And yes, we may go through difficulties and struggles and strifes and persecution, but we serve the risen Christ, who is coming with victory, power, and authority, and He's going to take us up to be with Him, and then we come in a wonderful time with Him. And so we look forward to that. Next week, I want to talk about the new heaven and new earth, and if we've got time, I might throw in there about the supper of the Lamb, marriage supper of the Lamb, maybe the judgment seat of Christ, maybe a couple of things in there. But we'll certainly have a look at those things. But I trust that your faith is lifted up as we look at these things, that you're ready and you're not afraid. That's the heart of the message today. Be ready, don't be afraid. Irrespective of however you look at these things, be ready, and don't be afraid. That's the heart of the message. Let's pray. Father, I just thank you, Lord Jesus. I thank you, Lord, that you are our coming King, our conquering King, Lord. We thank you, Lord, that we have the privilege of being sons and daughters of the living God because we've come into relationship with our Father through you. And Lord, your word says that you're not ashamed to call us sisters and brothers. And Father, we thank you so much, Lord, that we are your children, Lord, that we will reign and rule with you, Lord, for eternity, Lord. We thank you, Lord, for the victory of the cross, Lord. We thank you, Lord, that we are people, Lord, that are already, Lord, living with expectation, Lord, looking forward to the day, looking forward to your return, Lord, but in the meantime, about the work of the kingdom. And Father, we are people that are not afraid of what will happen around or what's going to happen or is happening or this or that. Lord, we just trust in you, Lord. We hold on to you. We're a people of faith. We have joy in our hearts because we serve the risen Christ who is coming again. And so, Father, bless your people, I pray this day. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Praise God. Bless you.
Father, we do thank you, Lord God, again for your word, Lord God, Father, I just pray, Lord God, that we will always be attentive to what you're saying to us, Lord, because I know, Father, you speak to us, Lord. You're speaking to each one of us, Lord God. So, Father, we thank you for a wonderful word again, Lord God, and we thank you for Pastor Chris, Lord God, that as he speaks what the Spirit tells him to speak, Father. The Spirit speaks through Pastor Chris. So, Lord, I just pray that that word, Lord God, will penetrate our hearts, Father. And Lord, we'll not just leave it, just we heard the word, a good word, but Lord God, we want to live your word, Lord. We want to hear, we want to live what you've been showing us, Lord. So I thank you, Father, again for today, in Jesus' name. Okay, we just don't forget to come on Zoom. We will be going on Zoom very shortly. Thank you.